I want to run a query to count how many bricks I have on my table here. Clearly, the more I have, the longer this is going to take. If I go and buy a whole boatload more, clearly this is going to take longer. It's the same with SQL queries. The more rows your query processes, the longer it's likely to take. But this isn't the whole story. You also need to look at how much resource your query consumes. Let's find out how. By looking at how many rows each step of the plan processes, you can get a feel for how much work it does. Fewer rows means less work, more rows means more work. But this is only part of the picture. You also need to look at how much resource each step of the plan used. The two key resources being CPU and disk. While both matter, for most queries, I/O, disk reads, dominates. So how do you know how much I/O your query used? You need to look at how many consistent gets it did. So what are these consistent gets? Why do they matter? And how do they differ to the number of rows? To answer that, we need to look at how the database stores data. When you insert rows to the database, they're not randomly spread across the disk. Each row goes in a block. And a block is the smallest unit of data access. Every time you fetch a row, you're not really getting just that row. You're asking the database to get the block it's in, along with all the other rows in that block. Then locating the row you're interested in within this block. It's like if, instead of having my bricks here just randomly placed across the table, what I do is I store them all in little boxes. Every time I want to get a brick, I have to pick up the box it's in and then find the brick within it. Every time I pick up another box, that's another consistent get. Side note, why are they called consistent gets? Well, remember that your queries have to return a read consistent view of the data. That is how the rows existed at the time your query started. So all the values are consistent to the same point in time. Some statements can also do current mode gets. Unlike consistent gets, which return how values existed at some point in the past, current mode gets show values as they exist right now. Each of these gets, also known as buffer gets or consistent reads, is an I/O operation and is relatively expensive. Worst case, the block you want isn't cached in memory, so the database has to fetch it from disk. This can be orders of magnitude slower than memory access. But even if the block you want is cached in memory, the database still has to do some work to ensure you only view data committed at the time your query started. So each of these gets is relatively expensive. The fewer gets your query does, the faster it's likely to be. For example, say I want to get 4 bricks out of my boxes here. I could have all 4 bricks just in this one box, so I can return them all with one consistent get. Or I could have to get 1 brick from each of the 4 boxes. So I have to do, in this case, 4 separate gets to get the 4 different bricks. So the second query does more work and is likely to be slower, even though it processes exactly the same number of rows. So it's critical you add this I/O information to your execution plan. Do this in SQL Developer by going to the Tools menu, selecting the Preferences, and locating Autotrace. Once here, select the last CR and CU buffer gets. While we're at it, also select the disk reads and writes and elapsed time. With these enabled, then run Autotrace for your query, and you'll get a plan that looks a little bit like this. Going down the plan to the first leaf, we can see this query first reads all the rows in the bricks table. This uses 42 gets and took 367 microseconds. These rows then flow up to the hash join. This then triggers the second join, which reads all the rows from colors in 3 gets, then fetches all the data from the pens table in another 42 gets. But what about the hash joins themselves? How much work did they do? Well, the gets, disk, and timing figures are all cumulative. So to see the values for a particular step, you need to subtract off the corresponding values for its direct children. Starting at the top, you can see the figures for the select operation are the same as those for the view below it. So this step did basically nothing. Going to the view and subtracting the values for the sort shows that this also did very little work. Walking down the plan, repeating this process for the gets, disk, and timing figures for each step reveals how much work they each did. When you get to the joins, you need to subtract off the values for both of its children. For the first one, this is the 42 gets for reading the bricks table, and the 45 for the other join. For the second join, subtract from its 45 gets the 3 for reading the colors table, and the 42 for reading pens. So it also did 0 gets. In fact, all non-leaf operations in this plan did 0 consistent gets. So does that mean they did no work? Clearly, no. The sort operation took well over a second. So what's going on? Converting the cumulative totals to individual step figures makes it much easier to see what's going on. You can see that this sort operation did a huge number of disk reads and writes. The dataset is too large for the database to sort it in memory, so it has to start writing it to and reading it from temporary disk to process it. As you can see from how long this sort takes, these disk operations are slow, showing that I/O is usually a performance killer. But what about the hash join at the bottom? We already established it does no gets of its own, and there's no other disk reads either. So what's it doing? This means it's able to process the join entirely in memory, and the majority of its runtime is burning CPU. If your queries are CPU bound like this is generally a good thing, because you can scale your application by adding more CPUs to the database. So to make your SQL faster, you need to review the execution plan and look for the operations that did the most work. That is, process the most rows, use the most consistent gets, temp disk, or just took the longest. But once you've found these operations, what can you do about it? Well, the first thing to check is that the query itself only does necessary work. For example, if your application fetches 1,000 rows, but then only keeps 10 of them and throws the other 99% away again, that's clearly a lot of wasted effort. You should have just fetched the 10 rows you wanted to start with. In which case, the solution is simple. Just improve your where clause. While you're at it, ensure you only select columns you need. A select star returns all the visible columns in the table. If you only care about, you know, what color your bricks are, also returning their weight, shape, price, purchase date, and general level of cleanliness is clearly a waste. You're transferring a lot of unnecessary data over the network. But even when your query only returns values that you require, it could still be doing a lot of unnecessary work. How do you spot this? By looking at the predicate section of the execution plan. View this in SQL Developer by going back to the Auto Trace preferences. Once here, go to the predicates branch option and select it. With this enabled, we'll get the execution plan for this query. We can see it does a full table scan of the bricks table, filtering the rows to just those where the color is red. This means the database is inspecting every single row and asking, is this red? 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 Until it's checked every single one. Clearly, this is inefficient. What can we do about it? Create new data structures to speed up access. The most common you'll use is an index. If we create an index on the color column and then run the previous query again, in the execution plan, you can see that the filter has now changed to an access, which means the database only inspects rows that exactly match your search criteria. Comparing the two plans, you can see both read 250 rows, but with the index in place, the database does substantially less work, just 3 IOs in total compared to 41 without it. Clearly, creating new data structures like this can make your SQL much faster. So we'll look at the hows and whys of these in future episodes. In the meantime, while tuning your SQL, you need to look at the execution plan and ask, which are the operations that do the most IO or take the longest? And can you change your SQL so you process less data? But ultimately, response time is king. Customers don't care how many IO operations your tuning efforts saved. They love the fact that the page loads 10 times faster. So above all else, measure how long it takes to run your queries and focus your tuning efforts on the slowest queries within the customer's process. Thanks for watching. When tuning SQL, what do you look for in the execution plan? Let us know in the comments and subscribe to learn more about SQL.